It's not afraid to go into those dark places. It knows, you see, joy is not happiness. Happiness, real joy, always is in relationship to suffering. It redeems suffering. It takes suffering with it. It makes suffering brand new. It heals suffering. Real joy is always in relationship to the darkness and depths of loneliness that exist in this world. It brings it into the light. It's not happiness that lives up here. It's not a stimulant. It's real joy, and our soul knows this, and it waits for it. It knows that it's happening. It knows that God is always good news. Good news. Now, some of you are doing things in your churches, in your life, in your ministry that leaves you dead, that leaves you drained, that leaves you more anxious, more isolated, more irritable with your family, more disconnected from people. You're doing meetings or activities that there's no life in it for you. I just want to tell you something. If it doesn't bring you to life, if it doesn't make you more soft with your own family, if it doesn't make you awake, if it doesn't make you smile, if it doesn't sound like good news, then stop doing it, because it's not of God. God is always good news. And any activity that you're engaged in that leaves you more disconnected, less yourself, less alive, more burdened, that's not God. Many of us are serving a God who leaves us feeling more ashamed, more disappointed, more burdened, more heavy, a God who we never really want to spend time with because we feel like this God would always be convicting us. And the sad thing is that God doesn't even exist. It's not real. Because the God of Jesus Christ is always good news. Always good news. Doesn't mean there's not suffering. But will we enter into suffering with Jesus because we know the last word. We know that at the end there is joy. There's new life. There's good news. And if it doesn't sound like good news, if it doesn't awaken your heart in some way, you have to question whether it's of God. If there's no rest in it, you have to wonder if it's of God. I want to tell a final story here just to sort of capture this. When I was when I was 13 years old, my parents got divorced. And I know there's many people here who grew up in divorced homes, or you work with kids who are from homes where the parents have split. And I remember when I was 13 and when this happened, you know, that researchers say that when your parents divorce, that's the end of your childhood. Your childhood ends that day, and that was definitely the case for me. You start to worry about them more and carry the grief of your parents a lot more. And so my parents split up, and there was just a gloom, just a wet blanket over our whole lives, and straight to the buttocks. And I would dance around my room. And I had never seen Disco. I'd never been to a disco dance. We didn't have television at that time. I didn't see Saturday Night Fever, so I'd never seen disco dancing before. But I had these little pictures on the 8-track cassettes of John Travolta and these different people. And so I tried to imitate them in my own way, just from these photographs on the cassettes. And if you were to ask me, where was God in your life during that dark time in your adolescence, where was God? And I would tell you without a doubt, God was coming through those headphones. God was telling me that the grief and the loss and the confusion I felt was not the last word. And I would feel that life, and I would dance around my room and on my bed listening to these tapes. And when I went to school during that time, I saw a poster, and the poster said, the student government of Jackson Street Elementary School is presenting the Night Dance. It was going to be a disco dance at the school. And the reason they called it the Night Dance was because they were going to do it at night. And I saw this poster and I was so excited. I was like, this is exactly what I've been looking for. I'm going to the Night Dance. And I went back and I told my mom and I said, you know, I need to get disco clothes. And so we lived in a small town, but there was a Kmart 60 miles away. We drove to the Kmart. I got a silk shirt. I got these pants, you know, and shoes and all this kind of stuff. And came back and I was so excited. And so the night dance came. It was Friday night. It was 2 hours from 7 to 9. And so I went there, showed up, super excited, super alive. It was like the best day. And I walk into that room, and they've got the disco ball. You know, this is the first time, remember, the disco ball showed up. It was like a revelation. It was like God gave us the Ten Commandments and the disco ball. We had a DJ, and he's playing this disco around, and the music's playing, and of course, you know what happened. I show up to this thing, and there's 150 kids in the junior high, 75 boys sitting on one side, 75 girls sitting, and nobody is moving. I go over, find my two buddies, I go sit to them. I say, hey guys, what have you been? Don't talk. Don't move. We're just gonna try to make it through this, man. And you could feel the sphincters of the entire room clenched. I just gotta survive this. Don't talk or move or it'll look like you're dancing. Just stay still. And so we're sitting there, trying to resist, shake, shake, shake your booty. The boogeyman, we're just sitting there. And 30 minutes go by, and 60 minutes go by, and 90 minutes go by, it's over. Two-hour dance, and I'm dying inside, and all of a sudden the DJ flicks on the lights, and he gets into the microphone. He says, well, it looks like nobody's gonna dance. I know there's refreshments. Why is everybody up? And everybody get up and get something to drink or something to eat, and thanks for coming. And I don't know from where, but in the deepest part in me, I just stood up and said, no way. And I walked over to that DJ. And I said, hey, you can't do this. We have 30 more minutes left. This is my only night dance. And he says, listen, nobody's gonna dance. So we're just gonna end it. And I say, listen, you put that music back on, and I'll dance. And he says, but you don't have a partner. I said, it doesn't matter. I said, you put that on. And so he walked over, and he turned out the lights. And I sat there in the dark, and I walked over to the middle of that floor, and I could feel inside me fear.
Is he gonna change clothes?
I don't know.
And great joy. And all of a sudden he turned on that disco ball. And I walked out to the middle of that stage. And I looked at that DJ and he looked at me. And I said, hit it.